Hi class, today we are starting with module number 2, the basis of European power. The topic for our micro lecture today is the crisis of the 17th century. During the 17th century, many states in the world were challenged by population losses, economic decline, rebellions, revolutions, social crisis, and political unrest. The crisis was linked to climate changes that reduced agricultural productivity worldwide. The period, often called the Little Ice Age, was a moment of cold climate conditions that threw rural populations into crisis mode. The downward pressure on food supplies was the main problem, but military competition was also part of the equation. There were civil wars in Russia and China and in Europe, religious divides, increased taxation, and social unrest. The climate of profound crisis led governments around the world to take emergency measures to restore order. These multiple reforms then became long-term transformations that modernized the state and increased its power to impose their will on the population. The European social order at the beginning of the 17th century was very hierarchical. In most European countries, monarchs were at the top, and often they were celebrated as semi-divine beings chosen by God to embody the state. Members of the clergy were also important thanks to their sacred role interceding with God on behalf of the people. Behind them, there were nobles whose privileged status derived from their background and leadership on the battlefield. Merchants also had prestige and power, which they achieved by buying their way into the nobility through favors and service to different monarchies during the 15th and 16th centuries. Peasants and artisans occupied the lower rungs of the structure despite being the majority of the population. They were expected to be loyal and pay deference to the rich and powerful. Contemporary historiography has described this structure as the great chain of being that linked God to his creation in a series of ranked social groups. Besides being hierarchical, European societies were very patriarchal. Men were in control of all social activities. Ideologically justified on religious law, these men were fathers not only of their children, but also their wives, servants, and apprentices. All of them owe masculine figures respect and blind obedience. Fathers were entitled to use physical violence, imprisonment, and other forceful measures to impose their authority. In the 17th century, most people in Europe lived in the countryside, but only a few peasants owned enough land to feed themselves and possess livestock. The access to technologies like the plow was limited. Laborers and farmers suffered a lot. Poverty, disease, and hunger were prevalent. When the cold weather of the Little Ice Age struck the continent, food shortages increased and the population diminished. The reason for this decline were reduced fertility, more susceptibility to disease, and outright starvation. Europe's emerging industries also suffered the effects of the crisis. The textile industry, the most important at the time, experienced a quick decline when wages stagnated and unemployment soared. The crisis, however, hit some countries more than others. France, Spain, and England endured great difficulties, but the Netherlands transformed into a rich and powerful empire. As predictable, the economic crisis triggered people's protests. Especially in urban spaces where uprisings multiply, causing many problems to the European powers. Unable to solve this social agitation, authorities at the local and national levels began to build governmental institutions that later became the basis for the construction of modern states. In some places, absolute regimes prevailed, while in others, constitutional forces raised up. Despite political and ideological differences, these European states aimed to expand and protect their frontiers, raise taxes, consolidate central control, establish social welfare programs, and compete for colonies and trade in the Americas, Asia, and Africa. Despite the many problems for centralizing authority, like the lack of communication networks, the linguistic and ethnic diversity, or the power of local leaders, both absolutist and constitutional governments achieved new levels of power and national unity. This can be clearly noticed in the growth and professionalization of armies, higher taxes, efficient bureaucracy, territorial expansion in Europe and overseas, and the promotion of scientific thought. Eventually, the centralization of power led to the construction of sovereign states, but that happened a little bit later. This is all we have for today. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.